Purpose of Negro History Month. Wilson vision was that someday a special week or a special month would no longer be required in order to appropriately honor Black Americans and their accomplishment, because Black history is American history, and that it should be a year-round school curriculum that we understand and learn about Black history year-round and not only 1 month of the year.
Amen. As Stevie Clark said, our history is a proud history, and it's the history that's still being written. Amen. Now we will be favored by a selection by Deacon Lee Shingles. Woke up this morning.
I woke up this morning with my mind. Hey.
There must be some. something out of kilter. I think between the Negroes of the South and the women at the North, all talking about rights. The white men will be in a fix pretty soon. But what's all this here talking about? That man there says women need to be helped in the carriages and lift over ditches and to have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helped me in the carriages or over mud puddles or give me any best place. I could wait as much and eat as much as any man could when I could get it and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen all those sold off to slavery. And when I cried out in my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. Then ain't I a woman? Then they talk about this thing in the head. What's this? What's this they call it? Oh yes, honey, that's it. What has that got to do with women's rights and Negroes? Right. If my cup only holds a pint and your cup holds a quart, wouldn't you be mean not to let me have my little hair made full? That man there in the light says women can't have as much rights as men, because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? Where did your Christ come from? From God and a woman? Man had nothing to do with him. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now, they're asking to do it. The men better let them. I oblige to you for hearing me. Now, old Sojourner, ain't got nothing more to say.
Hi, my name is Harry McDaniel. I was a after four stage and movies. I was the first Black woman to receive an Oscar for Best Supporting Actress for my role in Gone with the Wind. I was an American civil rights activist, publisher, and writer who played a leading role in the Little Rock integration crisis in 1997. Also, me and my husband and I started the Arkansas State Press in 1948. After moving to Washington, D.C. in the 1960s, I served on the Democratic National Committee and worked with President Lyndon B. Johnson on anti-poverty programs. Hi, I am Josephine Baker. I was a civil rights leader in the 1930s. I fought for civil rights for 5 decades. I worked with WEB, Marshall, and Martin Luther King Jr. I mentored well-known civil rights activist Rosa Parks.
Hi, I am Megan Nash. I was the leading strategist of the Students from Wing of the Civil Rights Movement. I was a member of a famous freedom rally. I also helped find the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, and the Summer Voting Rights Committee campaign, which helped blacks in the South get to vote and have political power.
Thank you. The primary class just shared with you some of the famous African American Amen. Some of our famous African Americans of the future. Amen. Sharing about the African Americans of the past. And a hand to Sister Mamie Singletary and to the primary class. Amen. Now we will have Symbols of Freedom by the junior class, followed by the ABC Praise Worshippers, who will bring to us Break Every Chain.
This was a new era of freedom in our country. only am I a preacher, but I was the leader of Operation Breadbasket, which was a company that helped businesses hire black people and sell their products. I have been involved in many activities helping black people become free and equal Americans, but my name is Jesse Jackson. This radio is my symbol of freedom because I have my own show where I use the radio to talk about things some people may not want to hear. I openly discuss civil rights and social justice. I've been called a man who is willing to tell it like it is. My name is Al Sharpton. I am Colin Powers. I was a 4-star general in the Army and the first African American to serve as Secretary of State. I worked with other countries trying to remove people who threatened to hunt Africans. Today, America, today I continue to work with children of all races, help the races, help them become better people.
I am Coretta King, and my husband was Martin Luther King Jr. After he died, I followed his footsteps by trying to create peace where I could. This building, the King Center, which I created, is a symbol of peace and equality.
I was a Baptist minister, but I became known for ending separation between black and white people. This is my symbol of freedom because I look ways to end violence and create peace. My name is Martin Luther King Jr.
My name is Oprah Winfrey. I grew up poor, but today I am one of the most richest and influential women in America. I use my TV show to talk about things that help people live their lives. I believe in equal rights for everyone, not just people of color. I was there when our nation elected the first African-American president in 2008. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to present the 44th president of the United States of America, Barack Obama.
I am proud to be the first African American in the White House. This is my symbol of this symbol shows how far our country has come over the years. In the year 1685, blacks served white masters as slaves. In the year 2009, we have a black president. I am sure over the years we have more changes to come. There is still more changes to come as a people, as a nation, to end discrimination. My only question is, can we do it?
Yes, we can.
Thank you.
Now we will have the presentation by the ABC Praise Worshipper.
Thank you.
him. Give our ABC Praise Worshipers a hand. In that name that's above all other names, amen, that can destroy every yoke and break every chain, amen. And we thank also the junior class for telling us about everyone from Harriet Tubman on up to Barack Obama, amen, amen. Yes, we can. Yes, we can, through the power of Jesus, break every chain. Now, the witnesses by the intermediate class, and Deacon Earl Williams is going to tell us about study and war no more. Amen.
April 4, 1968 was a tragic, historic day in our history, making the end of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life, told through the eyes of witnesses who were there on that day he died. This skit depicts the humanity of one of our country's greatest leaders, playing with the death threats, bombing scares, and even a physical stabbing. See what took place on that fateful day. See what the men by his side witnessed. Reverend Jesse Jackson, Reverend Ralph Abernathy, Andrew Young, James Pill, James Orange, and Reverend Daniel Billy Cowles. Then see how Dr. King's dream lives on in each of us, and why Dr. Kills believes God put him there to witness such a tragic event. You cannot hear the word civil rights movement and not think of the man who is famously behind it, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Be ye ready. But as he may have been in life, it seems death was what made him ultimately deny Dr. King. What follows is an account of Dr. King's final hours and events that led up to his untimely death on April 4, 1968. These accounts are based on who knew him best. Reverend Jesse Jackson, Reverend Ralph Abernathy, Reverend Andrew Young, James Bill, James Orange, and Reverend Samuel Milling Rock Cowell. These men served as Dr. King's aides, friends, and his confidants. They were the closest witnesses to his life and ultimately his death.
I will never forget the last year I was in the presence of my friend Anna Benson.
Ralph at work that day, and I was there with Martin and Memphis the day before the shooting to speak to the civil rights rally.
Jesse and I spent the day with Martin holed up in that small room of the Lorraine Hotel, and Martin was talking with melancholy.
He reasoned about the past, about his family, and how his parents went.
When he talked about his family, his face would light up and he would smile, but when it was quiet, Martin would get a far off look in his eye. Are you okay? Martin?
Yes, oh, I'm fine. A little tired, perhaps.
That's understandable. I don't know no one as much as you do.
The ache in my feet after days of protest marching, the death threats, the stabbings, and the jail time.
I suppose they've been thrown in jail more than most. What are we up to now?
About 17 times at last.
Knowing us, I'm sure that will be the last.
Just think about all the work you already accomplished, and there's so much more to be done. It's your lifelong dream.
You've heard the threats of violence, seen the bombs tossed into my home. There's even the threat of plane bombs right here.
You survived it all so far. You was put here for a reason, and that reason is a dream that was inside of you, that was inside of all of us.
As a Baptist minister, Martin Luther King Jr. was a moral leader to the community. He was a charismatic and powerful speaker, full of vision, determination. He never stopped dreaming of what could be. Yet, he was human. And as most of us, he was overworked and very tired.
Martin fought hard to maintain his sanity and continue his focus in the midst of all the surrounding turmoil. We better get going if we're going to make that rally on time.
Why don't you two go ahead of me? I'll meet you there shortly. I want to stay here and work on some ideas for one of our campaigns.
So Jesse Jackson and Ralph Abernathy took off for the rally at the Mason Temple on April 3rd, 1968. When they arrived, they were met with loud cheers and acclamations. Ralph recognized immediately that cheers were not for themselves directly, but because the crowd thought Martin Luther King was trailing behind them. Smiling to themselves, Ralph and Jesse immediately called Martin and told him, "You really better get out here."
And so he did. He was only supposed to speak for a few minutes.
But he got up there and he was in. Just as he got earlier that day.
Then suddenly his voice grew almost electric. He began to speak with an intensity and a power that so often accompanied his words. Words that would be forever immortalized in our history.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead, but it doesn't matter to me what now. Because I've been to the mountaintop and I don't mind, like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we, as a people, will get there to the promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of coming.
After that, Martin seemed like a new man.
The next day, Billy Cowles arrived at room 306 of the Red Hotel.
People often ask me, what did a bunch of preachers do for an hour in a room that night? Well, I can tell you, it was mostly just a group of friends hanging out. The conversations were lighthearted, and believe it or not, at one point Martin even started a brief pillow fight. There was nothing to signal the charge that I was about to hit.
Billy had bought a new house in Memphis that year and was honored that Martin Luther King had agreed to come over for dinner that night.
So, is everybody ready to the best home cook in Memphis?
I hope we're having some good old soul fashion food, fashion soul food, and not some that fancy French food.
Yeah, none of that filet mignon.
When have I ever invited you over for dinner and had anything but soul food? It's collard greens and cornbread and butter.
Well, I hope I can't wait until dinner time.
I promise you one of the best home cooking meals you ever had. See you at 5 p.m.
I thought you said the dinner wasn't until 6.
I'm coming for the milk, and I can assure you, sir, that the milk don't care if I'm wearing a suit or a garbage sack.
Speaking of garbage sacks, shouldn't Andy be back by now? Or Andrew?
I heard that.
I know, I saw you coming, so how'd you go?
How'd you what, though?
I've been in court all day fighting issues. I'm planning to organize another march for the garbage workers since the first one ended so loud.
Well, I hope they get here soon. I'm starving. Excuse me, so you think it will happen?
As far as I'm concerned, it will. I did my job, so now it's up to Beverly and James to do it.
Are you still at the church?
Last I knew they were. They were in their training and group of young people.
They want to be sure we don't have a repeat performance of the violence that took place at the garbage strike last time.
I'm anxious to hear how that went. Well, I hope they get here soon. I'm starving.
Well, we're waiting on them. I think I'm going to get a quick shave. I want to make sure I'm presentable enough there.
Then I think you better hurry because the bad Beverly car pulled up in the parking lot. James Orange is with him.
Man, I couldn't wait to get back to that hotel and tell Martin all that happened. I was pumped.
Bevel and I had been working all day with a couple hundred young people, discussing the most useful ways for them to be effective during a nonviolent protest.
I wasn't sure how it was going to play out, but we ended up with a good meeting. The feeling among the civil rights workers had been right all day long. They were in a playful mood.
I guess I was too. When we got to the hotel, I picked up Bevel and held him over my head. That's when Martin came out and said, "Don't hurt him, James."
None of us knew those would be the last few minutes we ever spent with Martin.
It was time to head over to Billy's for dinner, then on to another rally later that night. Bevel, Jesse, Andrew, and I were all waiting in the parking lot right below the balcony.
At one point, Martin was on the balcony. He was talking to us below the balcony.
Martin had gone out to the balcony.
He was talking to us below the balcony.
I was telling him, "You know it's cold out. You better go back and get your top coat."
Martin said, "Do you really think I need a coat?"
And then,
it was everyone's first decision to duck from covering.
We all thought the shooting would continue, but it didn't.
All it took was one shot.
I ran out of the room to see what happened.
I ran as fast as I could to Marvin. He lay there on the concrete balcony, still as could be. A halo of blood circling his head. I thought I was having a nightmare.
We all did.
But we were awake.
Within 15 minutes of the shot, Martin Luther King arrived at St. Joseph's Hospital on a stretcher with an oxygen mask over his face. He had been hit by a 30-point caliber rifle bullet that had entered his right jaw and traveled through his neck, severing his spinal cord and stopped in his shoulder blade. The doctors tried to do emergency surgery, but his wounds were too serious. Martin Luther King was pronounced dead at 7:05 p.m. on April 4, 1968. He was 39 years old. Everyone exits the stage and leaves.
For years, I wondered why I was on the balcony at such a tragic and pivotal moment in history. One day, I finally understood. I was there to be a witness. God put me there as a witness to help spread the message after the messenger was gone. I was there to help keep Dr. King's legacy alive, the dream of equal rights for African Americans. They could kill the dreamer, they could not kill the dream. The dream is still alive.
Stay warm no more. Find your way down my burden, down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside, find your way down my burden. Hey!
Minister Tim to pray for our offering.
Oh Lord, we thank you for this offering. We thank you for those who gave. We ask now, Lord, that you would bless this offering and let it be used for the enrichment of the Sunday school and your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for participating in our ministry of giving. And thank you to the intermediate class for that awesome rendition of the final moments of Dr. King's life. Amen. And to Deacon Williams for studying Word on Word. Now we are coming to the conclusion of our program, and we're going to go right into our last play. And this is going to be presented by the senior class. The name of the play is Here We Go. When Sarah Breedlove's hair starts falling out and it's developing red flaky patches, she decides to develop a new hair care formula, which was given to her in a dream. She doesn't think it sounds too crazy, but her sister, Lavinia, and her husband, Charles Walker, aren't so sure. Arguing that Sarah can barely breathe and knows nothing about hair products, Lavinia and Charles try to dissuade her. However, Sarah doesn't give up that easily. She knows that she was given the hair formula for a reason and figures if she can change her name to something that sounds more official, people will listen to her and buy her products. In the end, she says goodbye to Sarah Breedlove and hello to Madam C.J. Walker. And the rest, as they say, is history. The skit, Here We Go, is the story of the life of Madam C.J. Walker.
Where did I put them? I just had them just last night, so they have to be around here somewhere. Sarah, have you seen my glasses?
No.
Can you help me look toward them?
Not now.
But you know I can't see worth anything without them. Please come help me look.
I'm busy.
What could be so important that she can't even help her own husband find his glasses? She knows I can't see worth anything. Sarah, are you all right? Sarah, I'm coming. Sarah, hang on.
Ouch!
Oh, my head.
Oh, my lip.
Sorry, I don't have my glasses. I almost forgot. I'm coming, Sarah.
I want to go in there for you.
Why not?
It's not a pretty sight.
It sounds like she needs help.
Believe me, the kind of help she needs, you can't give her.
What's going on? What are you doing back there?
Nothing. I was just brushing her hair.
Then why does she keep screaming? Right, I fell asleep in the chair last night and I took them off so they wouldn't get broken. Thanks, Lou.
Sarah, are you done yet? Are you okay?
Do I look like I'm okay? Do you see what is happening to my hair?
Brushing her hair, big handfuls of it started falling out.
It's not that bad.
dream last night. And this big black man appeared to me and he gave me a formula that would help me get my hair back to normal.
Now she wants to develop the formula, go into the hair care business, and go door to door selling their products.
But you don't know anything about hair products.
I know that, Charles, but I told you, I got the formula in his dream.
From a big black man, yeah, I heard that part. I dreamed about eating chili out of my shoe last night, but that doesn't mean I want to open my own restaurant.
See, I told you it was a crazy idea.
Why is it so crazy? Because he used to work in a cotton field and you could barely breathe. That has nothing to do with hair.
But people around here know you. What makes you think they even buy your products or even listen to you?
You've got a point, but I know we can make this work. We can move out of town where no one knows me, or I could even change my name. That's it. I'll change my name to something exotic or mysterious.
B. B. That never worked. Face it, Sarah. You're way over your head. Now quit talking that foolishness.
Charles Joseph Walker, I'm ashamed of you. How dare you speak to me like... Wait a minute. I've got an idea. What if I change my name to CJ Walker?
You want to use my initial? That ain't happening.
Yes, it is. And I'll add Madam in front of it to make it sound more official. Madam C.J. Walker.
I've got to admit, she does have a point. Kind of cute.
And the name sounds official enough. People will buy anything. Besides, if the formula works, it won't matter. The product can speak for itself. What do you think, Charles?
You think you can really do this?
I might need some of your business background to help me. And Luke, I can use your help experimenting with the formula. But yeah, I think we can do it.
Count me in.
Great, Charles.
It's worth a shot. Okay, I'm in.
When should we start?
No offense there, but maybe you should start soon before you won't have any hits left.
But who said I'm going to experiment on my hair?
You know, I just remembered. I have to get to the office. They're calling me.
That's one way to get him out. Seriously though, Sarah, you really think you can work?
There's only one way to find out. Besides, my hair can get much worse than this.
I sure hope not.
We better get started then. I made a list of all the ingredients we'll need.
Okay, I'll go get them.
Thanks, Lou, for everything.
You're welcome. Besides, what are sisters for?
Well, goodbye, Sarah Brela. Hello, Madam C.J. Walker. This is one work. I just know it.
Amen. And we know that it did work. Amen. Thank God for Madam C.J. Walker. Amen. We all heard that, right? God be the glory. That ends our Black History program. And now I am going to turn it over for the invitation to discipleship to Pastor Simmons.
While Jesus and Shane will be singing, leading us in that song, may we stand as the doors of the church are open.
Do you got good religion?
Serve the Lord.
Do you got good religion?
Serve the Lord.
Congregation for coming out. We thank the superintendent,
putting on the program, amen. And all of the teachers and all of the classes for coming on out and rehearsing. God bless you, and I thank Sister Corma for allowing me to be worship leader this morning. God bless you.